is fascinating. I learned a great deal. So one of the comments in that was that many concluded that talking Black is about more than just words and sentence. It's a rhythm and a cadence and how we speak and communicate with our bodies and our hands. And Black folks have always talked about how it's about a rhythm. So here's a reflection for you to consider. Has anyone ever commented on the way that you speak? What did they say? Was it positive, negative, neutral? How did it make you feel? And how did you respond? So just take a moment to think about that. Has anyone ever commented on the way you speak? I'd love to hear anyone who might like to share. There's anyone that has
something. I can share, Stacy. So
I can't see.
This is Kalina.
Hi, Kalina. Thank you.
So when I started my higher education career, mm-hmm. almost 20 years ago, right? It's been a while. Time is flying. Mm-hmm. I actually had the pleasure of being the voice of the registrar's greeting. Hello, you have reached the office of the registrar's office. And press one for this department and press two. And because I was told I had a good speaking voice for like a recording, although I honestly do not like my voice. Mm-hmm. I always feel like I sound like a five-year-old when I listen to the voicemail recording, but everyone else hears something different. So that was the first time. And then since then it has continued, but that was the first time I actually was told, you know, you have a good enough speaking voice to be on a recording that 10,000 or more people on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Kalina, for sharing. Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. But just think about that as we move through our discussion today. So here is our, let me watch my notes.
I'm Stacy.
Yes.
This is for anyone that's been told that they sound a certain way, right? Or is it just specifically to, okay. Just, I'm originally from El Salvador, and I've always been told, like, I don't have, when I speak Spanish, Salvadoran kind of accent, then I don't sound like I'm from Texas. And then other things like I don't sound gay or that I sound gay. It's kind of like all over the place. So, you know, just wanted to throw that out there.
Yes. And, you know, and you have to think to yourself, well, what does that sound like? So what you have in your brain is a preconceived stereotypical notion of what you think someone should sound like. So people are always like, oh, you don't sound like you're from the South. And I'm like, okay, so this is one way that people from the South sound, right? So yeah, thank you, Santos, for that. So this first video we're gonna watch is just the first 5 or 6 minutes of the Talking Black in America documentary that I shared with you, because I think it just is a wonderful introduction that's gonna lay some foundation for us. So let's get started with that. Now I can share my sound. Y'all hear that? Julia, I can see you. Can you hear that right? Okay.
You want to make it full screen?
Okay.
You know, my father, who's an entertainer, wrote a song called Word Up. And it was about the language. It was about someone saying word up, right? That was the language of our street.
When I talk to people and I ask them about that, ask them about what blackness is, what black language is to them, what does sounding black mean to them, more often than not, it's about a sound and a rhythm, this sort of movement and fluidity. It's sort of imbued with this cultural richness.
Language is music. They say picture is worth 1,000 words, but you know, I feel like I grew up in an environment where a person could use a few words and it felt like 1,000 pictures.
I'm afraid it's one of the great dilemmas, one of the great psychological hazards of being an American Negro. One's born in a white country where one was once a slave, where all the standards, none of it applies to you. Obviously, I hadn't always talked the way I had forced myself to learn how to talk. I realized it was a cadence, it was a beat. It was not a question of dropping S's or N's or G's, but a question of the beat, really. It's that tone and that sound, you know, which is in me.
What defines talking black? Like, that's the real question to me, because talking black to me isn't insult when you say you're talking black or you're talking white.
Yeah, that's
because I choose to pronounce my words. I'm not talking black. I'm totally black. I'm black.
Yeah.
So every word that comes out of my mouth is me talking.
Yeah, but
so I'm talking black.
But you're not talking black because you don't sound black while you're talking.
And that's my point. And I'm offended by that. What do you mean I don't sound black? I'm black, so I sound just as black as you do.
While I think anybody who's African American, you speak African American language because it's about you, the person, being African American, what you use. At the same time, I'm sort of pushed on that notion when I hear people or know that people exist who don't really seem to sound in a particular way.
I'm told all the time if somebody answers the phone, oh, I thought you were a white boy. What was that supposed to mean? I'm speaking the way that my family spoke. But did I know the language? Do I know another language? Yeah, I know another language.
It's just like anything else. It's surely as a kid learns how to use words, they learn how to use them in the ways that they're being used.
What is it you know when you know African American English, when you know it as a system, when you use it as your native language? Speakers of African American English, from my particular viewpoint, are those speakers who grow up in African American English speaking communities.
Many people assume that black English is one thing. All black people speak it pretty much the same way. There are many, many types of black English here in the United States.
Certainly there are differences that are regional differences, but I think there's some core aspect, and I think that's shared by many, many, many speakers of African American English. But as a speaker who grew up in Southwest Louisiana, I do things with African American English that I might not expect my counterparts who grew up in some other areas to do.
If I walk up to him, I say, what's up? I'm speaking. I'm saying, hey, how you doing? I ran into some guys from New York up there in the middle of here, and we're in our big Burger King getting something to eat. I'm standing in line. They stand beside me. I'm like, what's up? And he just turned to me like, what's up? You know, to them, what's up means, they're like, no, I was speaking. I'm from Mississippi.
I mean, between Cali, St. Louis, Chicago, Detroit, Philly, New York, you'll get a different greeting, and that's just the start. I can go down to Atlanta and say, you know, what it do? Detroit, what up, though? New York, what's up, son? Cali, what up, blood? You better be careful where you at if you say blood, though. But they know if you say what's up, blood, it's family.
Well, I'm from a place where we don't use the dialect that I use here, but I'm able to maneuver with it. So you might hear, what up, shorty? What up, though? You know, and I'll just give them something that I have from Detroit. It'd be like, what up, shorty? I'd be like, what up, though? Or if you go to New Orleans, say, hey, Wody. The language gives you access and it'll give you a barrier. So the best thing to do is use it for your access.
All the standards that were created, none of those apply to us. That's what stood out to me. Was there anything in there that stood out to you? And then I'm going to send you all to, I know we have a small but mighty group, but I still want you all to have some time talking with each other in breakout rooms. Anything about that stood out to you before I send you to your breakout room? Anything that was new? Anything that you thought about?
I think for me, just the greetings, I've never really thought about that. I've been in situations where I've heard a few of those greetings. I was like, oh, I knew what they were trying to say.
Mm-hmm.
But I really understood that. Oh, maybe someone else had no idea.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Right. what I loved about it too was when he's like, you know, his what's up in Mississippi is not what's up in New York, right? So the regional dialects are different, even though it's the same thing. The intention may be different. Any other thoughts?
I'm also wondering if I haven't heard those greetings, are people not saying them when they say hi to me, if they're changing that around?
Code switching, we'll get to that at the end. Like scanning the environment, who's present, who am I talking to, how is it going to be received, how are they going to perceive me, what am I going to get? So there's all these things that in, you know, a matter of seconds goes through your mind about context and just where you are. Right? So the way that I show up at work is consistent with who I am, but the way that I talk to my son at home, you know, I say things at home that I never say at work. Right? So even though I'm always accused of talking like a white girl, I still have that language, right, of how we talk to each other. Like I was talking to my son the other day, and I said, so what we're not going to do, right? And he knows exactly what I'm talking about, right? So I would never come into a meeting and disagree with someone about a topic and look at them and say, so what we're not going to do, it's just, right? Because that's just not, that's code switching, right? Like I said, we know, I would like to offer a different suggestion, or maybe we could consider this. I would never say, so what I'm not going to do. Now I might say it to Katie, or I might say it to, you know, I know the relationship and there's what? Safety. They're not going to change how they see me if I switch it up. And that's also part of how Black folks live their lives every day. Who's in the room? Where am I? What am I doing? What's required? So I'm going to send you all to breakout rooms with these questions. I know there are a lot, but I'll put it in the chat. Do you think it's possible to determine someone's ethnicity from the way they talk? Right? Santos just gave us a great example. Well, you don't sound like you're from, right? What are some ways that language relates to identity? Do you think language should be included alongside other diversity qualities such as gender, race, sexuality, religion? Why or why not? Should we have just an appreciation of language diversity in the same way that we have an appreciation of diversity in other areas? I know that was a lot. I'll type it into the breakout rooms, but just think about those as I send you all to your, and we'll take like maybe 4 minutes. So this is just a quick, okay? Here we go.
get enough time.
I know. Oh, I'm going to be rolling. We're going to be
really good questions. And just when you get going.
Sorry. Okay, so here we go. So I would assert, and I'm not going to give you any time to process that one because we got some other ones to move on to. I would assert that we should, in fact, value language diversity as much as any other diversity. So our next, this one is from Saturday Night Live. It had over 30 million views. And it had me in tears. Thank you, Katie. Had me in tears when I saw it for the first time. So Black English is not just about the words. It's about the way of being in the culture, as you heard in the first video. It's about the rhythm, the expressiveness, the shared experience. And I welcome your thoughts afterwards. It's a good one. Hey.
What up? As money is paid in installments.
Okay, so you all just received some major insights, okay, into what we consider the culture. So all of that made perfect sense to me. And that's why it was so incredibly funny, because these are just the ways we talk about things. So I'd love to hear any reactions to that, anything that surprised you, or if there's anything in there that you didn't understand that you're like, Stacy, I'm gonna need you to explain to me what that meant. And I'm happy to do that. Anything in that one before we move on?
Stacy, I have something. I mean, I had yes. All, but what I think is interesting is the insight that provided. It's almost like, you're a fly on the wall listening to a conversation, right? And the reason why I think it's insightful is because for me and how I was raised and the interactions I've had within the culture, it's pretty accurate. Like, there were no lies told.
There were no lies told, no lies detected, right? Like at the beginning when he said, you know, your winnings will be paid in installments, right? Like that doesn't require any explanation at all, you know, within the community, you know? And so when we talk about Black English and African American vernacular, it's not just the words that are spoken, it's the meaning behind them and what that conveys and that shared common experience. So T'Challa he said, well, you must not have lived in America very long. Yes, that would be nice, but you haven't lived in our communities to understand what's sort of normative. But then he started to pick up on, he's like, oh, I understand now. So the cookout, the potato salad, how white folks cook is just kind of part of that lexicon of being a Black person and how we talk about it. Go ahead,
Lizzie. The other thing too is funny, the conversation within, like if you and I were having a conversation and someone would be over here, and I'm saying that because Stacy and I talk, right? When we see each other in passing, there's something about that response of like Stacy's, like Stacy, if I'm saying to you, I really like your blouse. Did I tell you about that one time? And then Stacy's like, mm-hmm, uh-huh. Mm-hmm. That response within the culture is very Black. You know what I mean? And I say that like, because I tend to, if I do it in a setting, say for example, I'm gonna use Marley as an example as my boss. She's pausing for me to say, uh-huh. You know, and it's like, you don't need to pause. I'm just giving you some feedback and listening.
Right. It's the call and response thing going on. Like I'm going to always be interjecting. And Karen, I appreciate you sharing that you don't own any paprika. Okay. I appreciate that as part of adding to that or moving our discussion forward. So also when we talk about students or just talk about, thank you, Lenise, for that connection and that context. A lot of our students, African-American students, feel that they have to put on a different face for everything, job interviews, talking to a professor after class, speaking in front of others. The discussion often centered on the importance of erasing the stigma around African-American vernacular English, especially in the classroom, to show that dialects are not correct or non-standard. They are simply different. But there is that pressure to conform to standard English. So this is a wonderful, quick spoken word artist who talks about how she speaks English in three different ways. I'm confident you will enjoy this.
Wow, look at this. 94% of people believe company culture is.
Today, a baffled lady observed the shell where my soul dwells and announced that I'm articulate, which means that when it comes to enunciation and diction, I don't even think of it because I'm articulate. So when my professor asks a question and my answer is tainted with the connotation of urbanized suggestion, there's no misdirected intention. Pay attention, because I'm articulate. So when my father asks, what kind of thing is this? My articulate answer never goes amiss. I say, Father, this is the impending problem at hand, and when I'm on the block, I switch it up just because I can. So when my boy says, what's good with you, son? I say, I just fall out with them people, but I done. And sometimes in class, I might pause the intellectual sound and flow to ask, yo, why these books never be about my peoples? Yes, I have decided to treat all three of my languages as equal because I'm articulate. But who controls articulation? Because the English language is a multifaceted oration subject to indefinite transformation. Now you may think that it is ignorant to speak broken English, but I'm here to tell you that even articulate Americans sound foolish to the British. So when my professor comes on the block and says hello, I stop him and say, no, you're being inarticulate. The proper way is to say what's good. Now, you may think that's too hood, that's not cool, but I'm here to tell you that even our language has rules. So when mommy mocks me and says, y'all be mad going to the store, I say, mommy, no, that sentence is not following the law. Never does the word mad go before a present participle. That's simply the principle of this English. If I had the vocal capacity, I would sing this from every mountaintop, every suburbia, and every hood. Because the only God of language is the one recorded in the Genesis of this world, saying it is good. So I may not always come before you with excellency of speech, but do not judge me by my language and assume that I'm too ignorant to teach, because I speak three tongues. One for each, home, school, and friends. I'm a trilingual orator. Sometimes I'm consistent with my language now to switch it up so I don't bore later. Sometimes I fight back two tongues while I use the other one in the classroom, and when I mistakenly mix them up, I feel crazy like I'm cooking in the bathroom. I know that I had to borrow your language because mine was stolen. But you can't expect me to speak your history wholly while mine is broken. These words are spoken by someone who is simply fed up with the Eurocentric ideals of this season. And the reason I speak a composite version of your language is because mine was raped away along with my history. I speak broken English so the profuse and gashes can remind us that our current state is not a mystery. I'm so tired of the negative images that are driving my people mad. So unless you've seen it rob a bank, stop calling my hair bad. I'm so sick of this nonsensical racial disparity, so don't call it good unless your hair is known for donating to charity as much as has been raped away from our people. How can you expect me to treat their imprint on your language as anything less than equal? Let there be no confusion. Let there be no hesitation. This is not a promotion of ignorance. This is a linguistic celebration. That's why I put trilingual on my last job application. I can help to diversify your consumer market is all I wanted them to know. And when they call me for the interview, I'll be more than happy to show that I can say what's good, what's aguan, and of course, hello. Because I'm articulate. Thank you.
So that was a whole vibe. That was a whole vibe. Questions, thoughts about that for our discussion? Why are certain ways of speaking denounced while others are praised? Why do we associate language varieties with character traits like uneducated or smart? How do the characterizations of certain languages relate to social and historical situations of the people who speak them? Why are these associations so strong and easy to produce?
I can go. I don't know. I don't.
Yes, Aaron, go right ahead.
Working on my laptop and on my phone, so that's why I can't see the whole room. I think a lot of it has to do, obviously, with the way Black people have been treated in this country in general. Pretty much anything we do is going to be scrutinized heavily. Also, though, I think a lot of people are just uneducated, right? Like, if you look at some of the rules, and I saw this maybe a year ago, if you look at some of the rules in West African languages, we've been able to retain those somehow through the slave trade, through being forced to speak another language. We still have many of the rules that the, you know, other languages from some West African countries. For some reason, most of my ex-girlfriends have all been African. So I've dated a Nigerian, a Ghanaian, most recently someone who was from Paris, but her parents were from the Cameroon. And they, like, they've told me that a lot of the ways that we speak as African Americans are similar to how they speak on the continent. And we come from the west part of the continent for the most part. So a lot of people are not educated about that. They also aren't educated, and I talked about this in our breakout room with Kristen and I think Gigi. Slaves had to have code languages, right? So this whole idea of code switching is not new. It's a part of our history here, right? If you didn't want the master to know that you were trying to escape, you found other ways to talk about it. And I think if people really understood about languages and about why we speak the way we do, it's all those things I mentioned, but a lot of people often forget that a lot of the quote unquote poor English that we speak, we learn from Southern whites who also spoke really poor English, right? Yes. And so people forget all of that. And as the video said, or somebody said, you know, I used to work with international students, many who were from England, and they were like, yeah, y'all speak funny to us all together, right? Regardless of race, regardless of where you're from, because that's our language, right?
Right.
So I think when people don't understand those things, they want to associate it with us being uneducated, low IQ, whatever, but they're really the ones uninformed.
Yes, thank you, Aaron. Yes. One of the other pieces, and I'll say this and I'll let someone else jump in, is it the concept of what she was talking about was centering whiteness, as whiteness and white language and standard English is the standard, but it's completely arbitrary. It's an arbitrary standard created and defined and enforced by whiteness, right? And so to Aaron's point, and this is in the next video, and this is what I thought was fascinating, is that we learned all of our language because they separated us from our tribal connections so that we couldn't communicate with each other. So then we had to only listen to the slave master, right? I got you, Julia. And then, so we created our own language. And then the thing that really struck me in watching this video, and we lived apart, right? The enslaved lived in one part. And so then within that community, they created that rhythm and that soul and that language and that communication. So it is in fact a language with rules. And you'll see that in the next video. It's not arbitrary, it's not wrong, it's not bad, it's not some lesser version of standard English. It has rules, and I wanna make sure we get to that part, because that was the part I was like, yes, yes, Julia.
People forget that language has historically, it's like this all over the world, not just with English, right? So you can, and it has to do with whatever the power structure is, right? So you can look at, Spanish, for example, and if you go to Spain and you speak like you're from South, like when I go to Spain, even with my accent, they make fun of me and say I sound like I'm from South America. And it just, with the subtle intention that South American Spanish is not as good as Spanish. It's a very colonial way of thinking. And, same thing, like within Italy, the different language structure, if you speak language from the north, you have a northern accent, you are considered more educated, more eloquent, and the southern accents are considered, the ones we see on The Sopranos, for example, are considered to be the lower class. Right. So it's a class issue. It's like basically whoever has the power and the money and writes the books decides that this is the way that this language is going to be spoken. And anything that is not part of that, is less than.
But then standard.
People will intentionally embrace that. I mean, why do teenagers speak the way teenagers do? Because they are creating an identity and, you know, giving both middle fingers to older people. I don't have to speak the way that you say to mom because mm-hmm. young people talk like this, right? So I mean, I think that it's fascinating when you study that language has been used forever from the dawn of time to create belonging, right, within a group and to also to buck the system.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you, Julia. So we're going to get to this next one, which is what really gives us a lot of meat and substance to in terms of like the specifics around African-American vernacular. So we'll talk about this on the other
this
side.
Friday.
I was going to let you have a little bit of fun on this trip. Sniff some buttholes and all that, but no.
Sorry.
Prepare for a comedy about a couple of rescues.
Can you give hugs now? You've never had a Lulu hug?
We don't exactly hug.
Dog, rated PG-13.
Check out this Verbo.
Oh, man.
Michael, they're your cousins.
Bay, squad, fleek, basic, no cap, bet, yes, turn up, spilling tea, got receipts, keep it 100, finesse. These are just a few terms and phrases that originated in Black communities and have become popularized, some might say co-opted, by mainstream American culture. But this trend predates the internet by decades. Americans have long embraced contributions to popular language from African Americans, arguably more than they've been willing to embrace the people themselves. This cultural dissonance is just one part of the long, complicated history of African American English. And to unpack it, I'm joined by sociolinguist and AAE researcher, Dr. Rachel Elizabeth Weisler.
AAE can go by several different names: African American language, African American vernacular English, and Black English. Ebonics was coined in 1973 by African-American psychologist Robert Williams, but since then, it has been co-opted by white speakers as a derogatory term, and thus is not used by language researchers. Despite the internet's obsession with slang, AAE is a lot more than a collection of colloquialisms. It is a complete and distinct sociolect, a dialect created by social rather than regional boundaries. It is perhaps one of the most culturally impactful varieties of English on Earth, but also the most misunderstood.
Other words. In 1619, the English privateer ship White Lion landed at Point Comfort in Virginia. On board were 20 enslaved Africans who were traded for supplies. This transaction is of great historical and linguistic significance because it marks the beginning of slavery in British colonial America and the beginning of African American English.
The millions of people kidnapped from Africa and forced into slavery in North America came from more than 45 distinct ethnic groups and spoke many different languages. In most cases, they couldn't communicate with each other or their captors. But communication is necessary for survival, and in this language contact situation, the enslaved people were forced to learn the language of their captors, made all the more difficult by the fact that they were not allowed to read or write. In adopting English, heritage languages were slowly lost, though some words did manage to survive in our lexicon to this day, such as yam, banjo, and okra.
There are several theories about the foundations of AAE. Perhaps it began as a pidgin, a hastily developed form of communication between groups that don't share a common tongue. Or maybe it was the result of English words being dropped into African grammar systems. But the most popular theory is that it grew out of the English dialect spoken by white rural Southerners of the time. In this region, slavery and then segregation kept Black and white communities separated, creating an environment favorable to maintaining distinct varieties of English. In the 20th century, millions of African Americans seeking opportunities and fleeing racial persecution relocated to large metropolitan areas in the North, known as the Great Migration, which is why today, AAE is associated with urban areas. There is a glaring misconception that AAE is a wrong or deficient version of what people call mainstream American English or standardized American English. But that isn't the case at all. And when it comes to language, views about right and wrong are often forms of social prejudice. AAE has its own rules of grammar, usage, and pronunciation that are as elegant and consistent as any other dialect. And contrary to negative stereotypes, speakers of AAE are not careless with language. Like all people, they are very aware of the rules of their native dialect and instantly know when they're broken or misused.
Are you sure that you want to get turned with your girls this weekend?
I promised them a free trip, and it's turnt with a T.
No matter what kind of English you speak, you're going to sound different if you're from New York City, Atlanta, or Philadelphia, and the regional phonetic variation in AAE reflects that. However, there are some common phonological features. TH stopping, where a D sound replaces a TH, so that this and that might be dis and dat. TH can also be replaced by an F or a V, so nothing and smooth might be nothing and smooth. Consonant cluster reduction, where multiple consonants at the end of a word are simplified into one. So for example, lift and test might sound like lift and test. The common pronunciation of ask as axe is an example of metathesis, in which two speech sounds are allowed in flexible order. Many English words were derived through metathesis. For example, bird and horse used to be brid and hros. Several others are currently undergoing it, like nuclear, introduce, and prescription.
In addition to sound features, AAE often differs from other types of American English in grammar, which is fairly constant across the country. One of the most maligned features of AAE's grammar is the so-called double negative, as in, I ain't see nobody. But this disparagement reflects a misunderstanding of how language works. Language isn't like math, where two negatives cancel each other out. In many languages like Spanish, Greek, and Hebrew, a second negative serves to confirm or amplify the negation, known as negative concord. For instance, the Spanish sentence, no vi a nadie, literally translates to I didn't see nobody. Even standardized American English employs a bit of negative concord. If you want to make this sentence negative, you have to adjust the verb and the object. The anybody serves the same function as nobody, to remind the listener that the statement is negative.
Some other grammatical features of AAE include possessive S absence. Instead of the man's hat or my mama's car, you'd have the man hat or my mama car. Question word order. Instead of why aren't they going, you might hear why they ain't going. Finna, which etymologists trace back to the southern phrase fixin' to, might replace going to or gonna. I'm going to go to the store might be I'm finna go to the store. Zero copula. The connecting verb to be can be removed from sentences where they would form a contraction. So who is that might become who dat, and she's my sister might become she my sister. Other languages like Japanese and Russian also employ zero copula. For instance, anadoma literally translates to she at home. No S on third person singular. MAE changes form only for third person singular verbs. I run, you run, she runs, we run, they run. Only one S in there. AAE keeps all verb forms consistent and regular. In many cases, AAE's verb conjugation can actually achieve more nuance and precision than mainstream American English. When I say she is working, I generally mean one of two things. Either she has a job or she is currently doing work right now. In AAE, those are differentiated. She working means that she is currently working at this moment. And she be working means that she works on a regular basis. And the third option, she been working. She is working and has been for a while.
Now, some of these features also occur in other varieties of English, and not all of them are used by every speaker of AAE. But taken together, they index AAE, which means they serve as a sign that points to a shared history and cultural identity. Because that history is fraught with tension, discrimination, and violence, it's not surprising that AAE is considered a controversial topic. It is the most broadly studied variety of American English, and has been the subject of many high-profile court cases over issues like school instruction and linguistic profiling in employment and criminal justice. Attitudes of stigma and language prejudice have forced many speakers of AAE to be bi-dialectal, able to speak both AAE and whatever is considered the mainstream norm of their region. Alternating between two different dialects or languages or social linguistic practices is called code switching. It can occur casually, the way bilingual children of Spanish-speaking parents will transition from English to Spanish back to English in one sentence. But it can also be socially mandated. Say, if you speak in a formal register of Japanese with many honorifics when addressing your boss, versus the more colloquial language you may use with your pals.
Most speakers of AAE are adept at switching to MAE based on context and setting, like a job interview or other professional situation.
You want to make some money here? Use your white voice.
My white voice.
Hey, Mr. Kramer, this is Langston from Regal View.
But this skill is not without its struggles. Having to constantly scan social situations and adjust one's speech patterns is a layer of extra mental effort that white speakers don't have to worry about. And speakers of AAE may face blowback from their own communities when code switching, being accused of trying to sound white.
You never want to be the whitest sounding black guy in a room.
There's also the question of why they should have to change the way they speak at all, just to make others more comfortable. It can be frustrating to know that, despite the linguistic evidence, many Americans still hear AAE as an inferior or wrong version of mainstream American English.
And yet, ironically, AAE is also one of the most copied and co-opted English dialects. Some non-black speakers might use features of the dialect to show affiliation with African Americans, or with traits they might stereotypically associate with them, like confidence, coolness, or toughness.
I keep my Tech 9 on my waist because I'm a gangster.
I know they don't mean any harm, but they don't realize how ignorant it is when trying to have that black voice that some whites try to do. Yeah. It really don't do well.
There are people like myself who do know what they're saying and could do it, I think is right. I honestly think I could.
Both American pop culture and youth culture rely on and are shaped by black cultural practices, products, and behaviors, including music and language. As these cultural elements radiate outward from urban centers to the rest of the world, slang expressions that originated in AAE are constantly being adopted by other groups. Groups that don't necessarily understand the background, context, and appropriate usage, but enjoy the social clout they bring.
AAE is a part of the cultural inheritance of many African Americans, and the strong sense of cultural identity is also one of oppositionality, of embracing the contrast with other groups and broader white society. The history that shaped AAE has more than its fair share of tragedy and violence, the societal effects of which we are still living with today. But the negative associations that many people attach to AAE cause us to overlook the triumphs, perseverance, and creativity that gave African American culture an outsized role on the world stage. Language, it turns out, is more a reflection of the overcoming of obstacles than the obstacles themselves.
Do what? What are you talking about?
I think I could write for you in your vernacular because of...
But what is my vernacular?
Well, because I hang out with...
Yeah, but what is my vernacular? What are you talking about?
Well, like this hug is all in my yoke.
Right, Dick. What are you talking about?
So now we're almost out of time, and I do want to share this last thing, but the thing that really resonates with me on that is to understand that it is in fact its own language. And Karen, I appreciated what you put in the chat because what I, and also in my reading, it I found an article that said that like in the, I can't find it now, where is it? Our education system reinforces these perceptions that consistently shame students for using AAVE, that was from The Atlantic. It's also reinforced by editorial standards. The AP style book avoids AAV in its definition of prescriptive grammar, right? And then it also talked about like speech recognition. It doesn't recognize African-American, all these things in terms of even artificial intelligence that we are not included in those pieces. So, but it is a vibrant, rich culture that even goes all the way to our former president. So this is an example of code switching. This went viral. Watch President Obama shake the hand of the white assistant coach and then Kevin Durant. Context, who am I dealing with? Who am I approaching? Who am I engaging with, right? And that was powerful because even at the highest level, he's still an African-American man, he's biracial, but that is in him to walk into a space and make those adjustments. And so this is just a question we don't have time to answer, but how have your perceptions of talking Black English changed? What have you learned about AAV? What about language in general? And you know, I'll always end with a quote. We ourselves are high art as African-Americans in this Black History Month. So I will take a few, I always stay for a few extra minutes. If you all have questions or thoughts or things you want to share, I always run out of time. But that last one was just really an example of the behavioral adjustment that is code switching, which has been a strategy for Black people to successfully navigate interracial interactions and has large implications for well-being, economic advancement, and even physical survival. So we have been taught, I'll give you this one last example and then I'll open it up if you have a few extra minutes. My family moved from a predominantly white, 99.2% white small town in Ohio when my daughter was going into the sixth grade. So she shifted from, that was her whole life, to where I was raised in Newport News, Virginia, to a school, middle school, that was predominantly African-American. And she was heavily intimidated. She's, you talk like a white girl, you dress like a white girl, like, where are you from? Why do you even act that way? So give it about 6 weeks maybe, and she's coming home. And at that time, that was in 92. No, yeah, doesn't matter. Yeah, it was in 2002. And all of a sudden, during that time, the kids were like ending every sentence with, yo, like, you going to the store, yo? And so she started coming in the house and I was like, what are you doing? And she's like, mom. And I was like, that is not how I told you to talk, right? And so I was like, look, you can talk, do all that talking that you need to do to be around your people in school, but when you come home, I'm gonna need you to shift. Cause I'm not trying to, that's an assault on my ears, right? Now I would never say that now, but she had to switch and adjust to be accepted within the community because she had not been a part. It was like T'Challa. She was now in this community, and to be accepted, even though she was in the talented and gifted program, which was another problem in terms of perception, she adjusted the way she talked so that she could fit in with her community. Because it makes a difference both ways. So I'm going to stop there. Any questions or thoughts or anything that you'd like to share in the next couple minutes? Any insights, anything at all?
I have something. What I realized that we also don't talk about is the perception of names. If your name looks or sounds Black, obviously, you know, if you were in the 70s and your name starts with a Kala, Na, Ta, by association, you're considered to be of African American descent. Mm-hmm. And I'm pretty sure if your name is Shaniqua, you know, then the list goes on. And it's so funny having doing the sexual harassment training, and I like how they're diversifying the names. We had Letitia, you know, and I'm like, oh, but it really does sound kind of weird after going through 20 years of training. And you're hearing Mary, Sue, John, and now you hear Letitia. And I kind of mean like, okay, we're making progress, but we don't talk about the names because that's also something that affects the Black community.
Absolutely, absolutely. Do you know why Black folks name their kids with those names?
I don't, I can only go for my name.
Okay, so I did a presentation for our student organization. So the student organization was a Black student union at another school, and they wanted to know. So we always had topics at our meetings. So I went and researched it. And again, just because I'm Black doesn't mean I know everything about Blackness and my experience, right? And so there's something like sociologically, I'm like, oh my gosh, there's reasons why. And so what I learned is that when you have like LaMichael, we'll just say that as an example, the La in front of Michael, this started happening in the like 60s and 70s when Black communities were trying to really centralize their identity. And it was about being anything other than white. So if I put a La or a Duh or a Sha or a Shaniqua, then that is owning my Blackness and raising it up because I am not going to name my children and buy into this white supremacist system. Does that make sense? And so it was really the anti, you know, it was the anti that and the celebration of us. I'm gonna make up my own name and identify myself the way I want to be identified. And I thought that was so, it was like taking back the power, right? And I just, it was fascinating that from a psychological and a sociological perspective, that there was meaning behind how we got here with Black folks naming their kids. Yeah, so thank you, Colleen, that's fascinating. Aaron.
I was going to say, I think that actually, you know, I think at some point, most African Americans fall victim to, you know, this society, right? Like, we're taught what the norm is. And in the video you showed earlier, white is the norm, even still, right?
Yeah.
I think for me, so my name is Aaron. My second brother's name is Robert. Very kind of safe, typical names. My youngest brother's name is Delvion. And I remember thinking, like, Mom, why did you do that? Why did you give him this ghetto name? And that was when I was younger. Mm-hmm. As I've grown older, I think we actually should be proud of our unique names, because yes. African Americans yes. are a wonderful example, probably the most prominent example of people being taken somewhere and building a culture from scratch.
Yes.
And that's a part of it, right? That is a part
yes.
of it, is the names, it's everything you said. It's also, those are cultural names, right?
Yes.
And so I think educating, you know, our faculty and staff, as you're doing, right? That we're gonna have people coming in with those names, and we need not to treat them differently, because there is data that when people apply for rental applications or job interviews,
yes.
they often are not brought in or
yes.
leased a home to because of their name.
Yes.
And so there's training even at the staff and faculty level here that I think is important
mm-hmm.
Moving forward.
Well, and the pronunciation, like
right.
get my name correct, right? Don't say, oh, that's a different name, or where that name could, no, don't go into that first, right? Go into, I want to make sure I get this right. Can you pronounce your name for me? Or,
right.
you know, if I didn't pronounce that correctly, you know, and I think that's standard, but it hits at a different, at sort of a deeper level, because, you know, they've spent their whole lives having their names mispronounced and being told, I'm not going to even try to pronounce that.
Right.
Right. That being seen, being embraced, for all of that, my name, the way I talk, Karen, to your point, the way I write, right? Because then when I was teaching, I would, you know, it was like, no, this is not a proper, right? I am guilty of that. And now having a greater understanding, you know, of different, just different ways of being and talking are all equally legitimate. Yeah. All right. We good? I know we could talk about this forever because it's just such a powerful topic, but what it does, it just creates understanding about how people live in the world. And for us to just embrace that. So, and just to understand it and to learn more. Like I said, you know, I was fascinated by that 1 hour documentary. If you have a chance to see it, I would encourage you, because it really goes very in depth about that experience. And I was fascinated myself and just pulled a few things out of there. So anything else before we go? Thank you all so much for celebrating Black History Month with me today. Appreciate you all. Thanks, Kalina. I'm glad. Thank you all for your contributions and as well. Appreciate you all. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
Thank you.